Good morning, saints. I trust that it's well with your soul this morning. For God is good. And all the time, God is good. Praise His holy name. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Please rise and let us sing that together. Our doxology. Church, where the Reverend Dr. Karita Kane Grizel is the senior pastor. We're truly glad each of you are here to worship with us today, and we pray that we will be spiritually blessed as we gather together in the Spirit of the Lord. And before we sing our opening hymn, we want to make a special announcement. The Little Methodist School is having their fundraiser, and they are meeting at Papa Murphy's. Pizza, bread, salads, desserts, and you can come and support this effort. 2095 Golden Century Lane in Gort River. Wednesday the 23rd of March between 11 a.m. and 8 p.m. Papa Murphy's, and I think that you might have flyers somewhere. If you don't, we will make sure you get them. We have a little time, so we'll probably announce it again next week and the next week. But let us support our children. They didn't ask to be here, we brought them here. So we need to support them. And the African adage says that it takes a whole village to raise a child. So all of us, old, young, and indifferent, all of us are part of the effort of raising children, whether they are a biological child or someone else's child. Children need leadership. And we can surely provide them, for they have all the energy to run where we can. God bless you. The opening hymn, Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hymnal number 2034 in your black hymnal. Praise God. You may stand if you want to. It's easier to sing standing up than it is sitting down. I learned that a long time ago.
To the name of the Lord.
of the Lord. He is holy and righteous. Like a yo-yo this morning, you gotta stand again. Yeah, you gotta stand again. Those who can stand, we're gonna lead you in the call to worship. This is what you call spiritual calisthenics. Yeah. So feel free to exercise. Jesus, we have seen your majesty.
And we are captivated
by the light of your face shining in the sun.
And your clothes dazzling bright.
You are more important than all who came before you.
More than Moses or Elijah.
More than any prophet, priest, or king.
More than any pastor, politician, or world leader.
In you, every message is confirmed.
Every message of hope.
Every message of peace.
Every message of reconciliation.
The identity and characteristic of God.
Made known to the Son.
Reckless forgiveness.
Reckless love.
We will look to you.
We will live by your light.
Until the day dawns.
And the morning star rises in our hearts.
It is well with my soul, number 377. Peace like a river. It's in your red hymnals, I think.
How good it is to have that peace that passes all understanding. Peace like a river, no matter what might be going on in our lives. God has promised us, and He is able to provide that kind of peace when we look to Him. So as we prepare ourselves for prayer, let us call out those names that we want to remember and for God to touch.
Prayers for Karenza Sampoff, who's just getting over having a sinus infection.
Can I have her name again?
Karenza.
Prayers for Dawn, who had a heart attack on Friday, and now needs a triple bypass.
Yes. Yes.
I have two blessings. One is for Lauren Guffey, who's been the adult Sunday school leader for our church for many, many years. And because of personal reasons, I guess, as of today, he has stepped down. But praises for him keeping us going even the last 2 years through emails and keeping us going. My other praise is that my sister is cancer free.
Continued prayers for my niece's husband, T.J. Winters, in Modesto. They've stopped the internal bleeding, but he's having fluid build up in his lungs, and they don't know why.
Yes.
Prayers for the people of the Ukraine.
And the people of Russia.
And him.
Yes.
Prayers for our world leaders.
Let us pray. Most gracious and loving Creator God, oh God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, oh God. You are the great I Am. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are Jehovah Nisi. You are Jehovah Rapha, oh God. You are Jehovah Tzidki, oh God. You are able, Lord, to do anything but fail. And so we thank you, O God, that we can look to the hills from whence cometh our help, knowing, O God, that our help comes from you. You made the heavens, earth, the seas, and all that exists in this world. And so, O God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, O God, for your mercy that you have granted unto us. But, O God, Lord, we realize and we recognize that there are so many things that are going on in our world. O God, we lift up to you, O God, the people of Ukraine, O God. Lord, touch in the name of Jesus, O God. Lord, give them the peace that passes all understanding. Lord, touch Russia, oh God. Lord, touch our world leaders, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we pray not only for the peace that passes under all understanding in ourselves and in our hearts and in our souls, oh God. But we pray, oh God, for peace in this world, oh God. Lord, 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 so many people are in need of you, oh God. Lord, so many people are hurting, oh God. So many people are even dying, oh God. So Lord, we lift up to you each and every person, oh God. Lord, even under the sound of my voice, especially under the sound of my voice, oh God. And touch even, oh God, those in the entire world, oh God. Lord, 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 we pray, oh God. We pray for peace in the name of Jesus. Father God, we remember the family of Stan Andrus, oh God. And Lord, we ask that you will continue to touch them in the name of Jesus, oh God. Lord, give them the peace that passes all understanding, Lord. Father God, we know that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. And so we lift them up to you and let them know you are with them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray, oh God, for Karenga, who has sinus problems, oh God. Lord, we ask that you will touch in the name of Jesus. We pray, oh God, for Dawn, who had a heart attack and is in need of a triple bypass, oh God. We know that you are able, oh God, to do all things, oh God. So we ask that you will heal in the name of Jesus, oh God. And as she goes, oh God, for her procedure, oh God, we pray that you will touch the doctors and the nurses and the anesthesiologist, oh God, and everyone who has contact with her, Lord. And we give praises, oh God. We give praises, Lord, for the one who was called out that is going somewhere else, oh God. But we pray, oh God, for good things, oh God, for we know that you are the one who gives us good and perfect things in our lives, oh God, when we look to you. And so, Father God, Lord, we pray, oh God, for Mary, oh God, who is having surgery, oh God. Lord, we touch, oh God, that you will move by your spirit again as the doctors and the anesthesiologists and the nurses take care of her. And oh God, Lord, we continue to pray for TJ, Lord. We thank you, oh God, for what you've done already, but Lord, he still has internal, he has fluid, oh God, in his body. So Father God, Lord, just touch, oh God. We know that you can remove, oh God. You can dissolve, Lord. You can do anything but fail. So touch him, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We continue to lift up to you, Paul Spiker, oh God. We continue to lift up to you, Sister Julie, oh God. We continue, oh God, to lift up to you all of those, oh God, who are in need of prayer. Oh God, we lift up to you the Clan Jack young people, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord. We lift up to you right now, Sister, oh God, Latrice, oh God. Lift her up, oh God. We pray, oh God, that you will find her that perfect place, oh God. In the name of Jesus. Touch her sons, Lord, in the name of Jesus, oh God. And Lord, just move by your spirit, oh God, and touch each and every one of us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Touch Sister Sharon Jackson, oh God. Lord, give her, oh God, all that she needs, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And give her the peace, oh God, that you are able to give us, oh God. And so, Father God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this time of prayer, oh God. If we have left anyone out, oh God, if we have miscalled any names, oh God, you know each and every one of them, oh God. And we claim the victory, Lord, in the name of Jesus, as you touch each and every person that we are concerned about and touch those things that we don't even ask, oh God. Touch us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you for the prayer that you have given us that we say, as you taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As Pastor was praying, I began to remember and reminisce. There was a chorus that saints back in the day used to sing, "I'm so glad Jesus lifted me." I don't know about you, but I'm glad. I'm glad that Jesus lifted me. I was a mess. And if you look at yourself in the mirror, you was a mess. We were all messed up, but God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son. And now you and I are here saying, I'm glad. Are you glad? Say, I'm glad.
I'm glad.
I'm glad.
I'm glad.
That's not loud enough. When you're at a game or a function, don't you scream it out? I'm glad.
I'm glad.
Maybe God might hear that last one. Old Testament scripture for the morning is found in Exodus chapter 34, 29 through 35, revealing the radiant face of Moses. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the covenant law in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant before, because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, so Aaron and all of the leaders of the community came back to him, and he spoke to them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near him, and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. Then Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went in to speak with the Lord. It must have been a shocking experience. Second scripture found in the New Testament, Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. Story of the Transfiguration. About 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up into a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor, talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and covered them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and did not tell anyone at that time what they had seen. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Father God, Lord, we just again come to you in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus, O God. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy and your loving kindness. We pray to the glorified Christ. We bow before the transcendent God, and we invite the elusive Spirit to fill us with power and with love so that we can represent this glorious God in our living each day. Touch, O God, and take me down into the deep hollows of your heart and your soul and your mind and your spirit, that I may preach the unspeakable riches of your glory. In our lesson today on this Transfiguration Sunday, I want to talk on the subject, a mountaintop experience. A mountaintop experience. In our lesson, Jesus takes his inner circle, his disciples, Peter, John, and James, up on a high mountain to pray. Luke, as always, emphasizes the importance of prayer. And Jesus gives us perfect examples of how you and I should live and how we should relate to God. In fact, the transfiguration happened at a prayer meeting. Yes, yes. And Jesus knew that it was important to give his problems to our Heavenly Father. Because anytime we face a problem, we always find Jesus as we turn to prayer. Before Jesus was tempted by Satan, he prayed and fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Yes, before he went to his death on the cross, Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Father, let this cup pass from me." And so it should be of no surprise that before his transfiguration, Jesus was going up on the mountain to pray. Although the scripture does not tell us what mountain, some traditional identifications of mountains are Mount Tabor and Mount Hermon. Mountains are usually settings for supernatural revelations and encounters with God. Moses and Elijah in the Old Testament had mountaintop experiences with God. Moses received the commandments on Mount Sinai. It was on Mount Carmel where Elijah exposed the priests of Baal as false gods, and they were consumed with a wet sacrifice. Now, as Jesus was praying, the three disciples either were sleepy or became bored. You know how the enemy does us sometimes. Satan comes at a time when we're trying to be with the Lord, or we're ready to go to bed, and we're praying, and all of a sudden we fall asleep or our mind wanders. That's how Satan does. He does it especially when something important is about to happen and we go to sleep, sometimes missing our blessings. So as Jesus was praying, something marvelously spectacular happened. Jesus was transfigured. The Greek says that he had a metamorphosis. I can say that. Metamorphosis. Yes, yes. Referring to a change of being that was for the benefit of his disciples. This was almost certainly a glimpse of Jesus before he became a man, as revealed his grandeur, his illustriousness of Jesus. It reminds us that although he appeared to us as a man, hidden within his human frame was the fullness and glory of God, the splendor and majesty of God. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white, reminding us of the way Moses' face shone after he had been in the presence of God. The white garment suggested a pure and heavenly being. So our scripture reading from Luke this morning gives us insights in the power of God. We can only imagine what it must have been like as Peter, James, and John woke up, still sleepy, on top of that mountain to see Jesus change before their very eyes in his full heavenly glory as he stood there talking with Moses and Elijah. He talked with Moses, who led the Israelites out of slavery and who was a lawmaker, and Elijah, who symbolized the prophets. So as Moses and Elijah spoke with Jesus, whose Hebrew name was Yeshua, about the exodus or departure he was about to accomplish through his departure, the crucifixion, he would deliver his people from bondage of sin and death and bring to fruition the work of both Moses and Elijah. The ministries of Moses and Elijah both featured suffering and rejection, and Jesus would endure those things in a much deeper level, for Jesus would endure the suffering of the cross, the rejection of the people who he had come to save from separation from God. And he took upon himself the punishment for all that are in this world, the sins of all the people. You see, Jesus is presented as the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. He did everything and more than what is required by the Old Testament law. He acted as the ultimate prophet or spokesperson of God. And I want you to know that Jesus does not make the Old Testament irrelevant, but he brings in the New Testament as a new way of God. The old is still a part of what we must follow and know, but it is a new way to God. The written law was useful and God-given, but as the history of Israel proved, it didn't have the power to transform people's inner attitudes. Something more was needed, and God had to change his people from the inside and out, putting his law into their hearts through the power of the Holy Spirit. There are three main things we can take from this text. First, the passage is a testimony of who Jesus is, as God's voice calls out from the cloud that surrounded them on top of that mountain, saying, "This is my beloved Son whom I have chosen. Listen to him." We remember that God said a similar thing about Jesus at his baptism. "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." The second thing that the text tells us is the preparation of Jesus' death. Luke tells us that Moses and Elijah appeared and spoke to Jesus about his departure, which was to bring the fulfillment at Jerusalem. This sets the stage for what will happen in the days ahead as Jesus begins his walk toward the cross in Jerusalem. Finally, this portion of scripture also gives us a glimpse of Jesus' eternal glory. My God, we are told as he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. And as the two disciples were waking up from their sleep, Jesus was transfigured on top of this mountain right in front of Peter, John, and James, three disciples. So when Peter, John, and James witnessed on top of the mountain of transfiguration, it was a miracle. This miracle of Moses and Elijah appearing on the mountaintop and Jesus being transfigured was a testimony to the fact that Jesus was truly the Son of God. Just as most of the miracles that Jesus performed were used to convince others of his divine authority, the account of this transfiguration is perhaps one of the greatest miracles that we can learn a great deal from. However, today it is all too common that folk dismiss away miracles. We are told that modern scientifically trained folk no longer accept the miracles of the Bible. But I want to tell you that I know that miracles do happen and I have experienced them for myself. Yes, yes. This story story of Transfiguration is a miracle that describes to us what we sometimes call a mountaintop experience of our lives. We've all had mountaintop experiences where we felt we were on top of the world and in the presence of God. Perhaps you had a mountaintop experience when you were married, or when your child was born, or when you received a special blessing or healing from God. Maybe your mountaintop experience occurred as you just quietly sat in prayer with God. Or maybe you remember an experience in your life when God brought you to the mountaintop and you felt that God was so close to you, you could just reach out and touch the hand of God. We remember the mountaintop experience that Martin Luther King Jr. had, that he described to us in his famous sermon he preached on April 3rd, 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee. His sermon was entitled, "I See the Promised Land." Martin Luther King said that he didn't worry about anything because he had been to the mountaintop with God. He said he had no fear, for mine eyes have seen the glory of the Lord. Yes, yes. Well, I want you to know that mountaintop experiences also prepares us for the valleys in our lives. We are able to make it through the valleys in our lives because, like Martin Luther King, we've been to the mountaintop with God. When we are in the valley of joblessness, or the valley of loneliness, or the valley of sickness, or the valley of depression, or in the darkest of all valleys, the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil, for the Lord is with us. We need to remember our mountaintop experiences and remember that just as God was with us up on that mountaintop, God is with us in the valleys of life. Yes, yes, mountain experiences are beautiful, but there is also a danger in mountaintop experiences. It is the same danger that Peter faced. It is a danger that we all face. For you see, Peter was so enthralled with the mountaintop experience that he opened up his mouth and put his foot in his face. I think his foot in his mouth. But I know that there are times that we sometimes wish we hadn't said something that we said. But Peter should have kept his mouth shut, like James and John, for they were all just waking up to see the Shekinah glory of God and was probably still groggy. The scripture says he was sleepy and he was groggy to understand the conversation between Jesus and Moses and Isaiah. He didn't want to leave. He wanted to stay and revel in it. Remember Peter's words to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter was out of his league, and as usual, he spoke out of turn. Yes, yes. For Jesus, Moses, and Elijah, we're talking about Jesus' departure at the cross. And he's talking about building a tabernacle. Yes, we know how good it feels to be in a mountaintop experience, but Peter just didn't want to come down from the mountain into the valley of life. He didn't want the glorious event to end. He wanted to stay right there and bask in this glory. But the danger of being on a mountaintop is that they are so wonderful and so revealing that we don't want it to end. Many folk try to live out their lives on the mountaintop, but
But life is not lived on the mountaintop. It is lived in the valley below. When Jesus, Peter, and James, and John came down from the mountain, they found people who were hurting and in need. In fact, they found a boy who had been struck by Satan. And watch this, as soon as he said this, what he said, God cut him off with a cloud that suddenly came over them, and they heard the voice of God saying, "This is my beloved son, listen to him." Many of us are so busy asking God for this and that we don't take the time to listen to God. God wants to tell us some things. He has things and mysteries that and things that will happen and things that he wants us to do that we need to hear. Lent starts out this week, this Wednesday. I'm just amazed at how quick the Lenten season is coming up. Ash Wednesday, according to the church's tradition. And during Lent, followers of Christ are to repent of any sin in our lives and giving up or fasting from a hobby, food, yes, or a habit that we enjoy until Resurrection Sunday. By doing this, we are recognizing that our God is a God and he is more important to us than anything in our lives. And one of the most important things we can begin doing right now and don't stop doing it is listening more to Jesus. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, my siblings, listening to him in your prayer life, listening to him through the songs that we sing, listening to him as we meditate, listening to him in that still small voice that he speaks to us and we sometimes ignore. Oh, I'm telling you, you can trust him. He is the creator of all things. He knows all things. He knows you through and through. He knows everything. And so we need to listen to him. He is the one who made us and not we ourselves. He is the one who the heavens declare the glory of God and the firmament that shows his handiwork. So no one can define him. No weapon can defeat him. His love is limitless. His grace is sufficient. His forgiveness is boundless. I'm telling you today, listen to him. Listen to him. Listen to Jesus. God instructs his disciples and the whole world. "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." So during this next few days and beginning right now, we want to make that change that was given on Transfiguration Day. And as we celebrate today, Transfiguration Sunday, let us begin to listen to him. Amen. Blessed are those who hear the word and do it. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. As always, we want to thank God for all of the blessings that he has bestowed upon us. And we also always want to ask and to give Jesus to anyone who has not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Some people think that all they have to do is to do a lot of good in their lives. But the scripture says in Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, then you shall be saved. So if there's anyone under the sound of my voice, streamline, land, and wherever you may be, please accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Just ask him to come into your heart, your mind, your spirit, your soul. Thank him for what he has done in your lives and even in advance what he's going to do. As you accept him as your Lord and Savior, thank him for saving you. Thank him for forgiving you and giving you that great salvation. Also, we know that when you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, then you need to find a church home where you can work out your own salvation along with other people, other loving people. So we welcome you to Fair Oaks United Methodist Church. You can call us. You can call us, and if we're not available, we will call you back. So call us at 916-961-6631. And we will love you. We will guide you into the way of Jesus Christ. Yes. We thank you for all of your gifts and tithes and offerings that you have given to Fair Oaks. And we pray right now that you will bless, that God will bless in the name of Jesus. So Father God, Lord, we just thank you, oh God. We thank you for all of the gifts and offerings that have been made, oh God. And we ask that you will continue to touch in the name of Jesus. Touch those givers who wanted but were unable to. And touch and multiply our gifts 100,000-fold, both in our lives and in Fair Oaks. And we will be so thankful and so careful to give you all the praise, all the honor, all the glory. In the mighty and powerful name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We are excited about things to come. I'm trying to decide what we can do for Lent, because Lent, especially Ash Wednesday, and it's coming so quick. It's coming on Wednesday. And so I'm trying to think. I don't know how many people would come for a Lenten service, but can I have a hand, see hands, if anyone would come for a Lenten service? All right. Okay, okay. All right, praise the Lord. So let us, I know it's short notice, but let us have a Lenten service on Wednesday evening at 6 or 6:30? 6:30? 6:30. Lenten service on 6:30. Amen. Amen. We'll figure out how we can do things without touching, and we will have the imposition of the ashes. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We are excited about our church anniversary.
that we will be celebrating May. We ask if anyone wants to join our group, you are welcome. You are welcome to join our fundraising committee that will be meeting pretty soon. This week, we need to meet this week. And so we will let you know exactly when that will be so that there will be all the persons who would like to join us in that. It is going to be a great celebration. 125 years total that Fair Oaks has been in ministry to the community and to the world. So that's something to celebrate about. And so we look forward. We look forward to what God is going to do as we have a great celebration out there in the parking lot, inviting other churches and other folks to come and celebrate with us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I do also have a flyer from Salvation Army that there's going to be a training program for medical assistance. So if anyone is interested, please give me a call. I don't have it with me right now, but I do have it. So please call me if you know of anyone who may be interested in taking that course. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. You look so beautiful out there. Yes, yes. All right. Well, thank you, God. Thank you, God, for all that you have done, how you have touched us, oh God. Lord, let each and every person, Lord, feel your presence, your power, and your anointing. And may the love of God, the graciousness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and rule in our lives, that we might be able to listen to you in all that we do. And now we thank you, Lord. We thank you. And we give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise. Meeting is at 11:30, so those who are members, please stay, and there will be